in the previous lecture, what did we do? We actually did what is known as whole domain approximation. So this was the whole domain approximation. What was the phi? We assume C0 plus C1x plus C2x square, like that. So you can then generalize this by, you know, just
C1 P1 plus C2 P2 plus so on up to Cn Pn,
right? So effectively that C0 plus C1x plus C2x square can be, you know, I am just replacing C0 by C1 here just to make it, you know, uniform in terms of, you know, formulation. And also remember it was only C0 there, and here you may be wondering it is C1 into some function of x, but you know C, it could be just, that could be just written as C0 x raised to 0, is it not? So just for maintaining uniformity for formulation, we are generalizing. Okay, the first, this could be a constant also. Is this clear? Okay. So now this is the what we actually started with. So each pi is polynomial function of x, either x, x square, x cube, like that. And then if we now take Poisson's equation, right, phi double dash is equal to minus h, right, and then the corresponding functional for Poisson's equations, now we know it is this. Phi dash half integral phi dash square minus twice phi h dx. So now if what is the function, this is the functional. So now, and this is phi. Now we will actually see, we will generalize the whole formulation that we did for that 1D problem. So what did we do there? Capital F is, now you can actually substitute phi dash and phi here using this expression. So, phi dash will be simply C1 P1 dash C2 P2 dash and so on square dx minus, now I am separating these two terms, that is why this 2 does not appear, 2 and 2 gets cancelled, and then this is twice phi h. So, this is phi h dx, right. So, this can be, you know, written in an elegant form using matrices, like this. So, half C transpose AC minus C transpose B. So, what are these A and B's? Aij is integral pi dash pz dash dx and bi is integral pi h dx. Now, how did we get this thing? It is simple. If we take, just say for simplicity, if you just take the two terms here and, you know, just forget about this integral, without the integral. So, it will be half C1 P dash square plus C2 P dash square, then that actually can be expanded to this form, right, and that can be written in an elegant equation consisting of expression consisting of matrices like this. So, basically this is a row vector, column vector of C coefficients, and this is a 2 by 2 matrix. So, if you expand this, you will get this. Same thing we are doing it here. Right. Now, you have got this capital F, which is functional or the energy, and now this has to be minimized, right. So, daba F by daba C will be equal to simply AC minus B. Derivative of this will be AC, because that is like, it is effectively like C square. So, C square derivative is twice C. So, it is A into C will be the derivative of this, and derivative of this will be simply B. So, it will be AC minus B equal to 0. So, the final matrix equation, linear system of equation, will be simply AC is equal to B, and what is unknown here? C, the coefficients. So, those can be easily evaluated because B is known to you,
depending on source conditions,
and A is actually, A can be evaluated, which we will see how to evaluate, right. And then we can, you know, further, if it was a wave equation, for example, then you would get one more term here. Instead of just these two terms here in F, you will get one more term here, C transpose DC. Why? Because for wave equation, you have phi term, is it not? Wave equation, it was phi double dash plus phi plus x is equal to 0. That was the wave equation. Poisson's equation is just simply phi dash plus x is equal to 0, where x stands for h there, is it not? wave equation is phi double dash plus phi plus x or h, x is h. So, phi double dash plus phi plus h or x is equal to 0. So, when you have phi in the equation, I mentioned to you earlier,
phi will become phi square in the functional expression, and which is
simply minus phi dash square is minus of, this is the phi that we assume, square. So, this again can be written in an elegant matrix multiplication form as minus C transpose DC, where Dij is simply integral Pi Pj dx. Now, here remember Pi and Pj are the corresponding polynomial expressions in x, right. And then again if you do minimization, then daba f by daba c equal to 0, and then you will get this, and then you will get one more, instead of just a c equal to b, you will get a minus d whole bracket into c is equal to b. So, again here b is known, is a function of source condition, and here a and d matrices are also known. So, they just depend on the material properties and the geometrical dimensions, as we will see more of this, what do they mean little later. So, now we will take the same example in one dimension, and we will solve it for Poisson's equation, and we will see how this generalized formulation can be used to get the final set of equation and get the solution, right. Now, here what we did earlier was whole domain approximation, right. So, it is difficult to choose the proper function. For example, it was C0 plus C1x plus C2x square plus C3x cube, like that. So, if it is a complicated potential distribution, it will be difficult to find a proper polynomial expression which can fit closely the exact solution, right. So, what we do, instead of choosing a polynomial function over the entire domain, we will approximate solution for each finite element. Now, we are slowly getting into finite element formulation, right. So, here what we will do, we will divide that one dimensional domain. Suppose this is one dimensional domain. So, this one dimensional domain is divided here into number of segments which are called as finite elements, right. And then over each element, for example, element number 1 between nodes 1 and 2, we can assume phi as a plus bx, which is much simpler, right. So, earlier also I probably must have mentioned you in one of the first lectures, when we saw numerical and analytical techniques. If suppose you have some solution like this, actual solution is like this, it is difficult to assume approximate solution which can closely match this over the entire domain. Rather than that, what you could do is, you could actually subdivide this, right, over number of segments. So, these are the segments, is it not, like that. Over each of these segments, you can assume a plus bx as the solution, because this segment is straight line. So, then that can be represented by a plus bx. Remember, this a and b will be different for different segments, right. So, that means for each segment the unknowns are a and b, but later on we will see, we will not actually solve in terms of a and b, we will eliminate a and b, as in fact done in this slide later, we will in fact eliminate a and b,
and then we will solve it in terms of nodal potentials phi 1 and phi 2.
How do we do that, we will see, okay. So, going further, so now if we agree that it is easier to approximate solution over each segment, and here we are doing linear approximation, right, instead of complicated higher order approximation. Then now we can proceed. Then for first element, for example, phi 1 will be given by a plus b x 1, just you know substituting the values of x 1 and x 2 and corresponding phi 1 and phi 2. So, phi 1 will be a plus b x 1 and phi 2 will be a plus b x 2. Phi 1 will be a plus b x 1, phi 2 will be a plus b x 2 for the first and second node, right. So, that will give phi 1 phi 2 in matrix form. You can write it this set of equation like this, is it not, because this phi 1 will be simply a plus b x 1 and phi 2 will be 1 into a, that is a plus b x 2, right. Now, what you do, you eliminate this a b, you basically you know by just rearranging this matrix equation, a b will be simply be equal to 1 1 x 1 x 2 inverse into phi 1 phi 2, and then if you expand this inverse, which is this, and x 2 minus x 1 be in L, right, that will substitute it later. So, you get this expression a and b. So, then phi 1 x, that means potential phi in element 1 as a function of x, this we are writing it as 1 x a b, is it not, and that a b now we are replacing by this column vector of a and b, we are replacing by this here, and x 2 minus x 1 being 1 by L. So, then we get 1 by L, this if you expand this, you will get this. So, effectively what we have done, this is a very important step. The phi potential in the element 1 is now expressed in terms of potential of only nodes, end nodes, right. Later on we will see why we are doing this, is because finally what we want to do, we want to minimize the energy. Now, energy for one element, for example, is function of potential at every point in that element, is it not, potential at every point, but that would be cumbersome to handle, and we are expressing now the energy of an element in terms of its potentials of its end nodes, and eventually now you can imagine that we will get the total energy expression as function of only the nodal potential values. If we can do it for one element, we can do it for each element, this same procedure. So, that means the eventual total energy will be function of only the nodal potential values, and that can be minimized by taking derivative of f, capital F, with respect to each of those potentials and equating it to equal to 0, and then we will get set of equations which can be solved. So, in nutshell, this is what finite element method is. We will see more of this and we'll consolidate this learning as we go ahead. So, now it matter of details. Now, what we are doing is we are phi 1, we are calling this as n 1 now, and this we are calling is as n 2. So, phi of 1, phi potential in at any x in element 1 can be expressed as n 1 phi 1 plus n 2 phi 2, where n 1 is this, n 2 is this, ok. Now, what are these n 1 and n 2s? N 1 and n 2 are the shape functions of nodes 1 and 2, right. So, what are their properties? You can see n 1 is equal to 1 at node number 1 and it is 0 at node number 2. You can verify that. If you put n 1, n 1 corresponds to node number 1, at node number 1 x will be x 1. So, this will be x 2 minus x 1 upon L, L is again x 2 minus x 1. So, this becomes 1, but same x 1 at node number 2 will be x will be equal to x 2, is it not, at node number 2 x will be x 2. So, n 1 will be 0. So, similarly, n 2 will be 1 at node number 2, right, and 0 at node number 1. This has to be there because see this expression. Phi, if you now substitute phi at node number 1, now remember this bracket means it is element 1, okay. So, phi of bracket 1 means this is element. Now, if I actually calculate phi of 1, right, phi at node number 1, it will be equal to n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2. But for this phi 1 to be equal to phi 1 here, n1 has to be 1, n2 has to be 0, is it not? Similarly, phi of 2, phi of x of 2 will be n1 phi 1, n2 phi 2. So, here it is phi 2. So, for this and two, these two sides to be equal, n2 has to be 1, n1 has to be 0 at node 2, is it not? So, this is what, this is logical, this is logical from, or this is obvious from these two expressions, as well as it has to be like that from this equation, clear? Now, similarly, phi of 2 in element 2, phi in element 2 as a function of x will be n2 phi 2 plus n3 phi 3, because element number 2 is actually between nodes 2 and 3. So, it will be phi x for element 2 will be n2 phi 2 plus n3 phi 3, and then n2 will be x3 minus x by l, and n3 will be x minus x2 by l, and then same set of conditions will apply for n2 and n3. Here I have just written it for n2, similar things will be for n3. N3 will be equal to 1 at node number 3, and n3 will be 0 at node number 2, right. Similarly, for element 3 will be this, right. Now, effectively what we have done here, this is again, now we are taking a 3 element example. We are taking a 3 element example, right. So, the total length, each length is L. So, the total length of your domain is 3 times L, and it is 3 elements and 4 nodes. Now, here n1, it is shape function of 1, will actually be 1 at node number 1, 0 at node number 2. That is what we have seen here. N2 has now two, you know, sets of expressions. N2 is in this element also, in this element also. N2 is 1 at node number 2 in both elements, right, and N2 goes to 0 at node number 0, at node number 1 and at node number 3. So, that is why N2 has two expressions. N2 for first element is this, N2 expression for the second element is this, right. So, you have to remember this N2 expression for the first element is not valid for the second element. Although you can always put some value and you will get answer, but it is not valid. This expression of N2 is valid only in first element. This expression of N2 is valid only in this second element, right. Okay. So, now and here it is written, note in element number 1 only N1 and N2 exist, right. N1 and N2 exist. In node number 2, N2 and N3 exist. In node number 3, or in element number 3, N3 and N4 exist. Now, here N2 is equal to 0 here on this, because N2 is 0 since it is undefined or invalid. Expression is there, if you put some x value, you will get some value, but it is not valid, right. So, that is what is explained here. This is called, as you know, rooftop function, is like a roof. So, it is called in some textbooks, it is called as rooftop function. So, N2, this is node number 2, N2 is 1 at node number 2, it is 0 at all, in fact, all nodes, all other nodes, 1, 3 and 4, is it not? And here for the entire this element, N2 is not defined at all. So, going further now. So, I have explained here, N2 has two expressions, one valid for between x1 and x2, other valid between x2 and x3. And remember, at actually node 2, whether you use this expression or this expression, both will give you a value equal to 1. Clear? That is why it is equal, less than or equal to, because that is the. So, now we can generalize if we have understood this. The phi at any x in the entire domain, phi at any x in entire domain of this three elements can be written as n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2 plus n3 phi 3 plus n4 phi 4. But we have to remember that in element number 1, n3 and n4 are 0. So, it will be simply in element number 1, it will be just n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2, because you know these two, n3 and n4 are 0. Similarly, for element 2, it will be only n2 phi 2 plus n3 phi 3, right. So, we are generalizing this. Now, let us solve Poisson's equation and see the procedure in 1D. So, first we are seeing in 1D, and then we will see later on after maybe 2 lectures for 2D. So, again we are solving Poisson's equations, phi double dash is equal to minus h, h representing the source. And we have seen this, the functional, energy functional to be minimized is this, right. So, the functional is this, phi dash square minus 2 phi h, the same thing we are taking here, phi dash square. Now, what is our general expression for phi? Phi is this. So, phi dash square will be, and remember here important thing, phi dash square, the derivative does not appear on this phi dash, phi 1 dash, phi 2 dash and all that. What is variable here with x and y? X, n1, n2. Here with variable is with x is only n1, because shape function. And you know, going back, if you remember the in finite element formulation, what we said in the variational formulation, what we are doing is the potential at every point we are just varying, right, is it not? We are varying. So, phi is not function of x, phi at every point is not function of x in this variational procedure. Is it clear? We are actually changing the potential values at every x, and we are seeing which combination of potentials at various nodes is going to give you the minimum energy, right. So, phi i's, that means potentials at various points, they are not being made to vary with x in our energy minimization procedure. Is this point clear? So, your shape functions are, all these shape functions are functions of x, right. So, we are only, that is why we are, when we are talking phi dash, we are actually only, so phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, they are not varying with x, is it not? Yeah, in the variational formulation. So, that then this is phi dash square minus again 0 to 3L, this is the total our domain, and then this phi into h dx, and phi is this h dx. So, now again this can be written in matrix form as half phi transpose A phi minus phi transpose B, we have seen this earlier, is it not? A I j will be N I dash N j dash dx, B I will be integral 0 to 3L N I h dx, and then when you actually dabba f by dabba phi equal to 0, you will get a phi minus b equal to 0, that will give you a phi equal to b. Now, see the difference, earlier it was a c equal to b. The previous case when we had done whole domain approximation in terms of, you know, c 0 plus c 1 x plus c 2 x square, is it not? So, there the unknowns were the coefficient c, and that was whole domain approximation. For over the entire domain we have approximated or we assumed some potential distribution, right. Here we have not done that, we have done potential approximation over each segment or element, is it not? And what are we, and then we eliminated those a and b, and we made the potential as a function of only the nodal potential values. Right, and that is the reason now our variables become phi, the nodal potentials at all these 1, 2, 3, 4, is it not? So, from those coefficients being unknown, that case we have come to the case where potentials at nodes, they become variables. You understood this distinction? Earlier those coefficients were variables unknown, C0, C1, C2, C3. Now here phi1, phi2, phi3, phi4 become unknowns, and then when we minimize the energy with respect to those phi i's, we will finally get potentials at various nodes, and of course there will be some boundary conditions, some potentials will be known. So then we will, you know, use those, and only some potentials will be unknown. So that we will see later, right. Now again little bit to understand here, finally now we have got, after the FEM, applying the FEM procedure. So what is the FEM procedure? We discretize the whole domain into segments. So we have discretized. So this is the discretization procedure. After doing that, we got this A phi equal to B. Now phi, of course, earlier it was a continuous variable. Earlier, when it was a whole domain approximation, or if you suppose if it was a some analytical solution, if we are trying to attempt, right, then phi would be a continuous variable. Here phi is not continuous variable, because now phi is only at the nodes of this discretized domain. So from continuous domain we have come to discretized domain. Aij, we got it here as this. So now this, how do we evaluate this? So when it is like Aij, when I is equal to j, and two case, there are two cases here. One is for nodes 2 and 3. Now you can see Aij will be integral 0 to 3L Ni dash Ni dash, because I is equal to j. Here I and j are there, but since I equal to j, it will be Ni dash Ni dash. And if you do it for, calculate for A22 for example, right, then Ni N2 dash, what will be N2 dash for first? Now see, this is the entire 0 to 3L domain. So now that we have split into 3, 0 to L, L to 2L, 2L to 3L. So we are calculating this N2 dash. So N2 dash here in the first 0 to L will be simply 1 over L, is it not? Because this is 1 divided by X, and X is L. So they basically it is defining the slope. In the second element L to 2L, that is this N2 dash, the slope is minus 1 by L, is it not? And here N2 dash, N2 itself is 0 in the third element. So this is 0. So if you evaluate, this will be 2 by L, right. Similarly, when I is equal to j, and this same thing will be true for 3, 3, only thing what will happen here in this element, this will be 0, because N3 will be 0 here. Here it will be plus 1 by L, here it will be minus 1 by L square, right, but the answer will still come 2 by L. But 1 and 4 is different from 2 and 3, that is diagonal element, because you know there is no connectivity on this side for 1 and 4, that is why it is different, because 2 and 3 they are common to 2 elements, whereas 1 and 4 they are only appearing only in 1, 1 element, is it not? That is why the diagonal elements of 1, 4 are different than the diagonal elements for 2, 3, right. So now we will see that this is again, you know, now if it is for example A11 will be N dash 1 square, so it will be minus 1 by L, because see N1 is reducing, so it is reducing slope, so it will be minus 1 by L square. And N1 is 0 in this other 2, so 0 and 0. N1 is 0 here, N1 is 0 here, N1 appears only here in the first element, right. So here it is 0 and 0, right. So here this you get only as 1 by L. And now let us consider off diagonal element, that means I not equal to j. Now you will get here Ni dash Nj dash. So now you consider again first case, say 2, 3, let us consider 2, 3. So this will be 1 by L, into 0, because one of the, because n3 dash is 0 here, is it not? In first element, n3 dash is 0, in the fourth element, n2 dash is 0, because n2 is 0. And I said n2 is 0 because n2 is not valid, expression is not valid, it is not defined there, is it not? So, only segment wherein both n2 and n3 are non-zero, and that is why n2 dash and n3 dash exist, is this middle segment, right? And in one case, the, you know, the slope is, this slope is positive, n3 slope is positive, so 1 by L, n2 slope is negative, so minus 1 by L, clear? And then that is why you get, if you simplify, this will lead to minus 1 by L, and this will be valid for other phi of diagonal elements also, where there is connectivity 1 2 2 1 3 2 2 3 and 3 4 4 3. So, where there is a direct connectivity between nodes, you will get minus 1 by L, where if there is no connectivity, you will get 0. So, no connectivity, there are 6 off diagonal elements, there is no connectivity between 1 and 4, because either n1 is 0 or n4 is equal to 0 in that, you know, integral evaluation, is it not? See, when there is no connectivity, so one of them will be 0, is it not? In the, for example, here, if is, you know, if you are calculating 1 and 4, right, you will find that in every segment, either n1 is 0 or n4 is 0 or both are 0, right. For example, in this segment 2, 3, both n1 and n4 are 0. Here n4 is 0, here n1 is 0, is it not? Okay. So, then these are the, then you get, then if you understood this, so effectively what we have done, we have evaluated all these, you know, matrix. We can evaluate similarly B matrix. B matrix is again 0 to 2L NIH dx. So, B matrix is representing the source. And then, you know, NIH. So, N, for example, for if you evaluate for B, B1, it will be only from 0 to L, because N1 anyway is 0 in the latter 2 segments. So, only 0 to L will come, is it not? Instead of 0 to 3L, because in the second and third segment, Ni is 0, N1 is 0. So, only first segment, and then you substitute N1 as X2 minus X by L, expression that we have already seen, and X2 is nothing but L, first element, X1, X2. So, X2 will be equal to L, right? And then you can evaluate this integral, you will get B1 as HL by 2, same thing will be for B4. Now, B2 and B3, now node number 2 and 3, they are common to 2 segments, is it not? That is why you got, you here you get 2 terms, because they are non-zero, N2 and N3 are non-zero for over 2 segments. So, that is why you get 2 terms here, and the corresponding expression, if you substitute for that, you will get B2 as H into L. Here it is, it was HL by 2, here it will be HL. So, effectively what is happening, nodes 2 and 3 are contributing to both the elements effectively, is it not, because they are common. So, then here, that is why here HL into 0.511.5, I have substituted B1, B2, B3, B4. So, these are our final A phi equal to B expression, equation, is it not? And then, you know, this can be solved by after putting the boundary conditions, right? And then, you know, you can solve unknowns, this, because this is known, this matrix is entirely known, this is known, H is known, because source condition will be given to you. So, H will be known. So, then you can calculate the unknown vector, which is phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4, and in this unknown vector, some voltages would be known, right. Now, one question may arise.
Why non-zero off-diagonal entries are negative?
Now, intuitively you can understand is like this. Finally, what we are doing, our basic thing is we are calculating the energy. So, half our basic thing is electrostatic energy is half epsilon E square. So, energy for each element is proportional to the corresponding electric field intensity magnitude square, right. So, now here there are three elements. So, the E will be, and let us assume in this example we are going to take this phi 1 we are taking at 0 and phi 4 we are taking it as 1, boundary condition. So, if this is 0 and this is 1, the electric field intensity will be directed from phi 4 to 1, is it not? So, you know, then that means electric field intensity magnitude here will be proportional to phi 2 minus phi 1. E square is for element number 1 will be simply proportional to phi 2 minus phi 1 square. If you expand this, you see these two represent the diagonal terms which will be positive. Those are the ones which are representing this diagonal term, and this minus twice phi 1 phi 2 half diagonal terms. This is just a, you know, logical explanation of why we are getting negative as off diagonal entries. So, now F phi equal to B, this was the equation that we got, is it not? Now, what we do? We impose the boundary conditions. So, boundary conditions are in terms of phi 1 and phi 4. Now, here boundary conditions are this: phi 1 is equal to 0 and phi 4 is equal to 1 volt, right. So, now actually what we are doing, we are just expanding this second row and third row of this matrix equation. So, that will be actually this, the second row is this, is it not, when we expand. And then you, what you do is, this known things you transfer on the right hand side, because the right hand side in any, you know, linear system of equations like Ax is equal to B, the right hand side is known, is it not? So, what you do, right hand side you transfer this phi 1 and phi 2. Now, phi 4 anyway is 0. So, this term does not come explicitly appear here. The term corresponding to phi 4, it is 0, is getting multiplied by 0. So, that is why it is 0 into phi 4. Whereas, here in third row 0 gets multiplied by phi 1. So, that is why here 0 into phi 1, right. And then we transfer the known potentials in both these equations on the right hand side, and then we get this. So, right hand side is completely known, H is known, L is known, phi 1 and phi 2, phi 4 are known, right. So, then what we do? We impose, effectively we you know, the matrix equation from 4 by 4 matrix equation, we get 2 by 2, the main matrix is just 2 by 2 now. And this is this, you know, these two equations are written in matrix form here, right. And then if you solve this, you will immediately get you know, the answer. So, for example, if H is equal to 0, that is Laplace equation, then it will be, you know, H will be 0 here. So, it will be simply phi 1 and phi 4 on the right hand side, and that is 0 and 1. If you solve this, you will get, you can just try, phi 2 you will get as 1 by 3 and phi 3 as 2 by 3, which is obvious because the whole domain is between 0 and 1 and they are equispaced points. So, the second node will have 1 by 3 volts, third node will have 2 by 3 volts, right. If H is equal to 1, that is Poisson's equation, then you will get phi 2 as 4 by 3 and phi 3 as 5 by 3, because the presence of some charge throughout the region will basically change the potentials as compared to the Laplace equation, okay. So, we will stop here and continue next time. Thank you.